My. No pressure. No, I don't believe I've ever given a public talk on sex or private talk on sex. And I'm as nervous as, what do they say, in a room full of rocking chairs. So, Linda, thank you for lightening things up a little bit. You know, as you get older, even if you're somewhat thin-skinned, you got to just say what's got to be said, right? And we have that ability to do that as we get older. So we've been talking all month about the unstatus quo that talks about topics that generally aren't spoken in a church. But in a transformational spiritual community, those are the very things that must be talked about if we're going to move from religious to spiritual. So kicking off the month, Reverend Jeanette talked about othering, the possibility of deep healing by raising our consciousness beyond the ethnocentric, that's a big word, it means beyond the tribe, the tribal tendency to find an adversary, the other, and make oneself or one's community better than. Now, where do we see this? We see it in politics. We see it in religion. We see it in sports, right? Go Oilers. But witnessing that tendency in oneself is the beginning of deeper emotional and spiritual intelligence that leverages the creative process that we teach here by diminishing cognitive dissonance. And I'll talk more about that later. Reverend Corrine, the next week, described how even paper-cut trauma impact our authenticity and awareness of one's intrinsic integrity. Through heart coherence and other modalities, we can release those trapped emotions that can set us on the road to profound healing. Now, I bring those up so that I don't have to talk about them, the othering and trauma in terms of sex. So Reverend Jeanette talked about othering, Reverend Corrine about trauma. This Sunday, I get to have sex. So my talk title, as you heard, is God is not watching from the bedpost, God is in the bed. And so my style is I'm an introvert. And so this is a challenge for me because I'm intellectual and boring. But that's my comfort zone. But when you ask Spirit for help, as I did 3 o'clock in the morning last night, you gotta be ready for what comes up. And so when I was thinking about God watching from the bedpost, came up was this whole bit on God watching from the bedpost. And so it opens like this. Jesus, what do you have for us today in the 2024 Kama Sutra Olympics? And Jesus says, well, we start with the wheelbarrow position. And we had a middle-aged couple that, you know, they just got right and did a great job. I'm just afraid they might not be able to get it up for the bamboo split. And so God says, well, the bamboo split is a simple position, but it can be tricky. And if I hear that woman say my name again, like she did in the crab legs, I'm going to have to deduct several points. This is And so Jesus says, well, let's cut to commercial. So the commercial comes up, and this guy is talking about, did you know that men spend 100 calories for each minute of sex, and women spend 70 minutes? And so we have 3 new positions that can increase your heart rate, your capacity for stamina, and your aerobic viability. So sign up today for sexercise. Now you can look that up, because it's a real thing. So that's what came to me, you know, you've got to be careful what you ask for. Ken Wilber says, sex is not a sin against spirit, but a direct road to spirit. There's so much to unpack in that statement, and I'm with him. So this is a caution, because I'm no expert and have strong opinions about this touchy topic. It's loaded with a lot of bad innuendo. It's a hard... I can't even say it. It's loaded with potential pitfalls around gender identification, swamps of confusion about relational preferences, and dead ends of helpful advice or how things are supposed to be. So, the question is, how is sex a direct road to spirit? And the answer is straightforward, but it's seldom easy. And this is it. We must be willing to embrace the wholeness of our humanity, including things we would rather ignore because they might be uncomfortable. I'll say it again. We must be willing to embrace the wholeness of our humanity, including things we would rather ignore because they might be uncomfortable. It's easier to insulate ourselves rather than being vulnerable. And repressing parts of our human nature is what gets in the way of intimacy, of into me see. It's a block. However, the highest levels of physical, mental, emotional, spiritual intimacy are available to everyone. Yet it requires a highly developed spiritual maturity to wake up and experience what's possible. So how do we develop that maturity? Well, you notice that when people first fall in love, how wild things are. They're open and delightful. The honeymoon period of a relationship, right? You just love to be in love. As the relationship progresses, the ship hits the sand, right? It becomes more intense, which can bring other emotions with it, like fear, worry, anxiety, doubt, jealousy, all of those things. And when those things arise, what happens to intimacy? It kind of evaporates. And what happens to sex? It diminishes. Woody Allen says, love causes tension. Sex relieves it. And relief of tension is absolutely necessary, but admittedly, it's a lower bar to intimacy, right? So the other piece of wisdom that I got from Woody Allen was that when you date someone for the first time, give them a kiss right away, because it relieves the tension of that. And that's what I did with Reverend Kath, and it worked, so. So the depth of intimacy that you can achieve correlates to the degree of authenticity in the relationships that we develop. So we're talking about us developing the intimacy consciousness. So what's in the way of that? Well, it could be a really long list. 20 years ago, it was a simpler time, when my 5-year-old son asked, "Dad, what's sex?" And I said, "Sex refers to identifying what are called genders, male sex and female sex." And then I heard nothing, which was fine by me. I know some of you may be thinking, "Reverend John, you could have done better than that." But what else do you say to a 5-year-old? I mean, I don't know what parents are doing these days with this issue. I remember as a 12-year-old in parochial school, that's Catholic school if you don't know what that is, religion was taught in virtually every class with a big emphasis on the sacraments, confession and Holy Communion. And the greatest emphasis was on weekly confession because you needed a clean slate, a white, pure soul in order to receive Holy Communion on Sunday. So for impressionable youngsters, there was a lot of talk about sin, especially around the idea of impure thoughts. You ever hear that before? Impure thoughts stain the whiteness of your soul. So that conversation was really a low bar to get the kids in compliance with the sacraments. It was an easy thing to do, just think about all the impure thoughts that you have. So as a 12-year-old boy, going to confession on Fridays before Sunday, each week, Father Frisbee, and that was his actual name, can't make this stuff up, would hear from me, "Bless me, Father, for I have sinned. I got angry at my sister. I swore three times and had 28 impure thoughts." And he'd say three Our Fathers and three Hail Marys and make a good act of contrition. And the next week, it was the same thing. "I got angry at my teacher. I fought with my brother. I swore seven times and had impure thoughts 43 times. Week after week after week, the same thing. Because it was important to keep track. And no, the idea of personal best didn't come into play, though the temptation was there because there were so many pretty girls and penance was so easy. But the whole thing was a systemic process which was based on humiliation and shame about everything, but especially about sex. And especially at that age, it did stain our souls, if by soul you mean our consciousness. That was embedded in us. Even Reverend Kath, as a 12-year-old girl, confessed to adultery. She was convinced she had sinned because her brothers might have seen her in her underwear as she put dirty laundry in the laundry chute. We were trained to search for labels to categorize our sins, first determining if they were mortal or venial sins. Anyone remember that? A mortal sin was like a felony. A venial sin was like a misdemeanor. So, you know, when you're searching for these, what choice did she have? She had to find something, so adultery made sense. I can't imagine what the priest was thinking. So you were being shamed to confess your unworthiness, your human nature, before you were able to receive communion with the divine. These are mild examples of my experience. I can't imagine what was unfolding in the world, as we all know, a lot of terrible things. So where did all this come from? All this shame, all this humiliation. So I have to take a break here and tell you that there's in the new modalities of healing woundedness, the idea is you want to create a different relationship with what has wounded you. For me, I'm triggered by the word original sin. Okay? So I had to create a new story about original sin, and that's what I'm going to talk about next. So this is my story about original sin. So to understand this, you have to go way to the way back machine, back when the dinosaurs were roaming the earth. For millions of years, there was no climate change. It was millions of years like being in Florida for a season. Hot, rain in the afternoon, the next day, repeat. For millions of years, there's no climate change. Then all of a sudden, something happened, and the climate changed dramatically for 100,000 years. It was just churning, and that's when the mammals rose up. And what scientists have discovered, and I don't know how they did this, but they discovered that plants, especially larger organisms like aspens, discovered through some sort of intelligence a way to migrate to areas that were more for them to thrive. And they called that niche chasing. Now, I know you can also pronounce it niche. To me, you know, it's like a French accent. Anything you put a French accent on is sexier. So we have niche chasing. which sounds like a Kama Sutra position. So anyway, back to the story. Now imagine a time when primitive humans, on the brink of an evolutionary leap, they were traveling together in a herd, because this is before the recognition of a tribe, and one of the females in that herd pointed to a cave, and with winter coming on, that's where they migrated to. Now, the rest is history, because her awareness of this was an intelligence that had risen up through her to ensure evolution and the thriving of her community. Now, the awakened tribe flourished. They ate more protein, which developed their brains, and developed an oral history of the wise female shaman who saved the tribe. And the story was passed on from generation to generation. Now, generations later, there was another tribe that had discovered writing. And some clever wit thought that this legend would make a good story and called it the Garden of Eden. And it was a bestseller for thousands of years. The story made that distinction of not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, but rather from the tree of life. And whoever wrote it took the woman and demonized the goddess for having the ability to make careful discernment and distinctions. And as a consequence, sex became a source of shame and embarrassment, and they were tossed out of the garden to live in the wilderness. And here we are today. For me, the original sin is not Eve eating the apple, but the writing of a story from a clearly dysfunctional mind. And so that's how I can not be as triggered emotionally whenever I start talking about something like sex and shame, original sin, of the innocents starting out with a stain on their soul. The ability to make discriminations and distinctions accounts for the most profound advances in science and civilization. But until 100 years or so, these distinctions weren't seen as part of human behavior. They weren't categorized in any way. And until the 100 years ago, 150 years ago, Sigmund Freud is famous for originating the words ego and id. But from what I've read, it's more accurately translated to be the I and the it. And this was the distinction of self-recognition that Aboriginal woman saw, is to be able to say, I am here and it is over there. Is that making sense? And so that's a huge advance in consciousness to be able to make those distinctions. So when I'm overwhelmed by a feeling of anger, there can be a recognition of not knowing where it, the anger, came from. Eckhart Tolle talked about the same thing when he was contemplating suicide. He said, the I that was thinking of suicide is very different than that I that is sitting here on the park bench. So for the past thousands of years, based on that bestseller, we've been culturally shamed about sex. And it's deeply embedded in humanity, and sometimes it's outpicturing in disturbing ways. And Wilbur cites a study where zealous anti-homosexual crusaders were shown images of homosexual erotica, and it demonstrated more sex arousal in those people than in the average male. So in repressing those feelings and trying to rid themselves of them, they projected that into any activity that would get rid of gay men. Almost any politically charged topic of gender identity and relationship preference follows a pattern. So repressed feelings, in many cases, break down any chance of intimacy. This is further complicated and compounded by this complexity around so many aspects of sex that nowadays leave people totally confused. When I say I'm a white cisgendered male, it gives no indication of romantic or relationship preferences. And there are always a lot of assumptions. Becoming aware of the distinctions and validating the diversity of gender identification is a critical evolutionary advance. We have to learn that there are differences. By the same token, I can say, as an older white cisgendered male, I struggle with the proper use of pronouns and understanding relationship preferences. It's like learning a new language. As a good ally, or as good an ally as I may try to be, I frequently make a lot of mistakes. But I'm not the only one, and it doesn't diminish my awareness of how validating gender ID is critical. At the same time, I've noticed that sometimes those that most ardently insist on correct gender identification are often the most intolerant and give no leeway for my struggle and incompetence with proper usage. Which means the door slams shut on any possibility of intimacy, into me, see, for either one of us. By the time we get to relationship preferences, I looked up what polyamory, again, this is from Spirit telling me, look up polyamory. And there are 5 different definitions or types of polyamory from, let me read them, hierarchical, non-hierarchical, parallel, solo, and kitchen table polyamory, and don't ask me what that means. You know, you get to the point where you say, okay, whatever makes you happy. But you see, pushing the evolutionary validity of all these preferences is essential for us going deeper to understand diversity, inclusivity, and equity, isn't it? This is the work that we have to do. And I understand navigating all these labels, you know, it may be helpful to put things in jars and put them up on the shelf, but we can forget what's up there and what the ingredients are in them. So when we carry an implicit bias or confusion toward identity into a relationship, or when we carry intolerance of relationship preferences, or when we carry unresolved issues about sexual trauma, bringing any of those things into a relationship leaves little room for sexual curiosity, creativity, intimacy to naturally and healthfully emerge. So if we want greater intimacy, not just sexual intimacy, we have to become aware of unresolved feelings and change our relationship to them. So how do we do that? Well, this is where it gets a little tricky. Telling myself that I am rich, healthy, and strong and happy doesn't heal me when I feel poor, sick, weak, and unhappy. It's a form of spiritual bypass. Telling myself is not enough. Peter Senge, in the book The Fifth Discipline, describes that we must root out the ways that we habitually deceive ourselves. That means we need to work. You have the picture of shoveling and digging out the ways that we habitually deceive ourselves. Now, The Science of Mind was written at a time when the ideas of the evolution of consciousness were just emerging through the works of Freud and Jung, you know, in that period. It was all brand new. And much has been discovered, as Melody mentioned in her presiding, much has been discovered about the actual science of the science of mind since Ernest Holmes wrote about it. Just in the past 20 years, Science has discovered the neuroplasticity of the brain. We were taught that it was hardwired, that you couldn't change anything. The neuroplasticity of the brain is now recognized and the ability to grow new brain cells. In the past 15 years, memory reconsolidation, trauma-informed therapy, and other modalities have exhibited new methodologies to transform our lives. Much has been learned about the evolution of consciousness through the works of Ken Wilber, Otto Scharmer, Betty Sue Flowers, and many others. And none of these diminish the creative process that Ernest Holmes was pointing at. In fact, they affirm it. But cognitive dissonance, it's not enough just to change my thinking, because cognitive dissonance is embodied, and the body must be involved in dissolving it. The ancestral shame about sex is deeply embedded in our culture, which means it's embodied in each of us. So because of the great discoveries made in the last 100 years, it's become incumbent upon us to use these tools to clean up the self-inflicted cultural wounds, especially around shame and sexuality. And that's what a transformational spiritual community, that's the work that has to be done. So, I repeat, and I ask this as a call and response. Are we willing to embrace the wholeness of our humanity? Are you sure? Are we willing to include things we would rather ignore because they might be uncomfortable? So as we begin to root out the ways that we habitually deceive ourselves about sexuality, we can begin to see what Ken Wilber was talking about when he said sex is not a sin against spirit, but a direct road to spirit. Maybe we can start having better conversations about what we like and don't like in bed. Maybe we can set aside labels and become more curious, have greater clarity and consensus about this incredible gift that has been given us. Maybe we can move beyond satisfying a basic urge or relieving tension and start to enjoy extraordinary sex. And perhaps even as we shed worn-out ideas and shadowy habits, we can see what the mystics of all ages have experienced and pointed to, and that the becoming one with the divine happens through sexual union. Joni Mitchell sang, "Let's get back to the garden. Let's eat of the fruit of the tree of life. Let's celebrate our humanity and the ecstasy that awaits us as we transform lives and inspire people to make a positive difference in the world." And so it is.